Can I go ahead?
Yeah, sure, please.
Okay.
Before you start, Jay, can I request everyone to turn on the videos? It'll just be better, I guess. Everybody can see each other. Yeah, please go ahead, Jay.
In the previous discussion, in the previous lectures, we basically started with global optimizations, and we discussed that those tasks basically require knowing a property X at a program point P, and basically knowing that property would require the knowledge of the whole program. So we started with global consistent propagation, and now we went to light distance analysis. So the aim of this global optimization is to look at the statement, say X equals something, and figure out, like, is it dead code, or do I need the statement in the so can I remove the statement or not? So that basically depends on whether the variable X is being used anywhere in the forward flow or not. So the question to ask is the X live or dead at the start of the statement? I'm hearing echo from actually, so.
Could you try again? I just muted myself. Could you try again?
It's great. So basically the question to ask was whether the variable X was live or dead at just after the program point. So what that means, that a variable X is live after a statement if it can be used further in the data flow logic. And let's say once we have figured out all the liveness values at the program points for the variable X, then we can basically check if a statement is dead code or not. So if a statement say X equals something is dead code, if X is dead immediately after that assignment, so X is not getting used, so we can just remove that statement. So we model this liveness analysis as a DFSL, and basically we express liveness at the program at a program point based on the successor program point. So it's a backward data flow analysis, which is actually opposite from what we did in global constant propagation. There we did that that in of the successor statements would depend on the out of the predecessors, and the out of a particular statement would depend on the in of a statement. But here it's the exact opposite, that out of a predecessor statement would depend on the in of the all of its successors, and in of a statement would be related to out of that statement. And at every program point, we isolated a Boolean property for a particular variable X. So that property is true if we, by that we say that the variable X may be live. And if the property is false, then we say that the variable X is definitely dead. And then with these two values, we again had an ordering between these values, which was that false is less than true. And on the basis of this ordering, the GLB function, the greatest over one function of two values, versus the Boolean all of those values. And then we discussed the rules. And so basically for the first type of rule, the predecessor out statement would be depending on the successor in statements. If X is live at before any of the successors, then X has to be live at the predecessor out statement, because X may be getting used in any of the paths. So GLB effectively captures this rule. So the predecessor out is the greatest lower bound of the successor, all the successor in statements. And for the other rules, considering just one statement, so if the statement uses X, then the in of that statement would definitely be true, because X is getting used there, so we might need that value. And if the statement is X equals some expression, and the expression does not refer to X, so in that case, the in of that statement would be false, because just before that statement, we do not care what the value of X was before that statement, because it's getting a new value is getting stored anyway. And if the statement does not refer to X at all, either in using it or to assigning it, then the out is same as the in is same as the out of that statement. And the liveness algorithm was similar to what was in global constant propagation. We would initialize all the values to false for all statements and for all the variables, and we would just repeat until all the rules are satisfied. So it was just another fixed point iteration algorithm. And we just started with the greatest element. We initialized all the values to false, which was the greatest element. So we wanted to start from an aggressive answer. And then from this analysis, we can from the rules we can see that all the values change at most once. So the convergence is guaranteed. We have a bound on the worst case execution time. And once the analysis finishes, we can use it to identify dead code, as I said earlier. Then we model some other global optimizations, such as common sub-expression elimination and copy propagation as DFA analysis. So the first one was common sub-expression elimination, where we maintained a set of available expressions at every program point, so that if a sub-expression is available just before the program point and that statement uses an expression which is available to us, then we would just replace it with the temporary or the derivative. So here the value set would be the set of available expressions. And here also we established a partial order on two subsets. Set 1 was less than or equal to set 2 if set 1 was the subset of the other. Here we had the conservative value, which was the empty set. So it was conservative because it's empty. We don't have any available expressions, and we won't do any optimization in that case. Similarly, we had copy propagation, which was very similar to common sub-expression elimination. Instead, just we would now be focusing on statement of the form y is assigned to x. That's it. Then we move to register allocation. So the intermediate representation that we have been discussing up till now, it uses an unbounded number of temporaries, which actually helps in code generation and other optimization. But at some point, finally, we have to translate it to assembly, which, as in the machine has a limited number of registers. So we need to have a register allocation, which is basically renaming all the temporaries to the register in such a way so that total register does not exceed the actual number of machine registers. So the idea is basically to assign multiple temporaries to each register without changing the program behavior. So it will be a many-to-one mapping. And from henceforward, we will be discussing only the static mapping, where if a temporary is assigned to the register, then that mapping will hold for the entire program duration. So basically, if two temporaries, T1 and T2, can share the same register if they're not live simultaneously at any program point. Because if they are live at any program point, then they cannot share the register without changing the program behavior. So the idea is to basically do the liveness analysis and figure out all the live variables at every program point, and then construct a graph where each node is there's a node for each temporary, and there's an edge between two temporaries if they are simultaneously live at some program point. So this graph is called register interference graph, and it basically captures all the information that we require to characterize these assignments and give a global picture. So once a graph is made, we can basically reduce the problem to a graph coloring problem. So basically, where the graph coloring problem is basically we have to find a coloring which is an assignment of colors to all the nodes so that neighboring nodes don't have the same color. So it's exactly same as our problem, because here color denote the machine registers. We don't want any temporary to be in the same to be allocated to the same register. It's an NP-hard problem. So now after that, we would be discussing about register spelling and other stuff.
Okay, great. Thanks, Jay. That was an excellent summary. I don't have much to add actually to the summary, so that's great. So let's open the floor for thoughts, comments, questions. This part of the video.
So I had a question about this common sub-expression elimination process. So the example that you discussed about in the video. So in the last block, there was a expression d equal to y plus z, and that's and earlier in the block we already had that x equal to y plus z. So essentially, at the end of this process, should I share the video? Will that help? Or
well, I guess I was able to pull it. I was able to pull it out, so that's okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So at the end of
one way to kind of do this is either you can share the video. Yeah, I think why don't you share the video for the benefit of everybody? Maybe that's the easiest thing.
Yeah, let me open that. Yeah, it will take probably a minute or so.
So why don't you ask your question first, Sonu? Because I was able to actually access it. You can also share your screen.
So the sub expressions which are present at the end of this entire program is x comma y plus z c comma a plus d, and then we do not add d comma y plus z because y plus z is already available and it is mapped to x. Is that correct or is my understanding wrong?
No, so I mean we would add both x comma y plus z and d comma y plus z in this case, right? Because it's possible that x gets killed later on.
But then right.
We want to kind of keep this information that it's still available. Y plus z is still available.
Okay, so I think in the video probably that, or I did not get it. I think I missed that. Let me.
I see. So did I get that wrong in the video? Could you just point?
I can check it. Yeah.
I see. Okay, I see. Thank you for pointing that out. I can see the error. Why don't you make a comment on the video? Thank you. Yeah.
So we will we will have both the expressions at the end. Is that correct?
Absolutely.
Okay. I see. So in that case, is there a way we can get rid of this d equal to y plus z because we'll be doing two computations or I don't know.
Yes.
Can we
basically when we have d equal see, there are two parts to it, right? One is available expressions. Mm-hmm. And the other is actually eliminating the common sub expression.
Right.
So when I do available expressions, I don't need to worry about, can I eliminate or will I eliminate and things like that. I just kind of keep collecting all my available expressions. And so that would include both x comma y plus z and d comma y plus z. Okay. Then later on, I can say, okay, let me start doing elimination based on these available expressions, and then I can say, okay, x comma y plus z is already available. This is d equals y plus z. Why don't I just eliminate that to d equals x? All right. And then even then, the available expression results really don't change because it's okay, right? And maybe later on you want to do copy propagation and you want to get rid of, let's say, d altogether.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, great. Let's move on to the next question. I can't see on my interface who put their hand first, but maybe let's start with Weber.
So I wanted to ask two questions. So one is, in the videos you told that we started with assigning false value of false to all the node points in the liveness property DFA, and so you said that we can also do it with let's say true value, but instead of that doing with false would give some level of preciseness, and even if we do it with true value then we will be able to go through it, but so can you discuss how can we, so basically I think we will have to assign values such that at least one of our rules must not be satisfied so that we will get to something otherwise.
Okay, so let me try to repeat the question just so that I'm sure that I understand your question. The question is that we initialize in our liveness analysis, we initialize all the points, especially all the internal points, program points, with the value false. Now, what if I initialize all the internal program points, not the exit, not the boundary condition, but what if I initialize all the internal program points with the value true? Would it I claim in the video that it's still going to give me a correct solution, but not a precise solution. Yes. So, so are you asking? Can you explain that? Do you want me to explain that statement, or is that what the question is? Or
Can you please discuss how assigning the true values would also give the correct solution, or not just in this Linus, but in any kind of DFA, let's say,
okay,
assigning
sure.
trivial kind of solution. Yeah.
Sure. So notice that the semi-lattice is organized in such a way that if a value x is less than equal to a value y, then it is always okay to replace y with x. So if the correct solution had y's everywhere or somewhere, there were some points which had y as a solution for any DFA, then it's always okay to replace it with x, because x is just a more relaxed version of y. That's what the less than equal to operator means. If x is less than equal to y, that means x is like more conservative, more relaxed version of y. And so if I look at constant propagation, then maybe x is saying that it's not a constant. It's potentially not a constant. Look, I'm not saying it's definitely not a constant. I'm saying it's, I can't say whether it's a constant or not. It's like a don't know answer, right? Similarly, in liveness, I'm saying whether, it's either not live, which is good information, which is false, or it is live. When I say it is live, I'm actually saying it may be live, right? I'm not actually, claiming that it's definitely live. Actually, claiming that whether something is definitely live or not is actually an undecidable problem in the Turing model of computation, right? Because you want to basically say whether this value is actually consequential to the actual result, final result of the program. Now, maybe the program has lots of convoluted logic in which, let's say, it's doing some complex arithmetic, like huge expression. And that it just so happens that when you simplify that expression, that variable just gets cancelled out all over, right? But then, you have to do such a complicated reasoning to be able to figure that out, and that's beyond the capabilities of an automatic algorithm, at least today, right? So, even in the theoretical sense, in the Turing model of computation, that would be an undecided problem. So we are never claiming that something is definitely live or something is dead. No, but we are basically doing a best effort analysis, saying that something is definitely not live. I mean, it's very obvious. Just looking at the syntactic structure of the program, it's very obvious that something is definitely not live. And we want to capture that. And the other answer is the conservative answer, which is true, which is saying it may be live, right? And so whenever there's a conservative answer, then it's also always okay to replace false with true, right? I mean, it's always okay to replace an answer with a more conservative version of it. It's going to lose precision, but it's not going to lose correctness. Now, if you start off with a conservative answer, then you can only notice that the fixed point iteration can only take you down.
No. Yes.
So if you start at a lower point versus if you start at a higher point, if the higher point was going to get you to point A, then the lower point will always get you to a point which is less than equal to A. Okay, I mean, that's an intuitive answer. I'm not kind of doing this in a very formal way, but if I just look at all the program points, then if I take a solution, by a solution, I mean a vector of values, one value for every program point. Let's say there are two solutions, solution A and solution B. Solution B is less than equal to solution A if for every program point, the corresponding value in B is less than equal to the corresponding value in A. Now, if I start with B, then I'm guaranteed to get my eventual fixed point solution will be always less than or equal to the fixed point solution if I started with A. And so that's your answer, right? I mean, so it's okay to start with B, but it's just, you're probably going to lose out on precision if you do that.
Yes. Yes, sir. So actually in the video I was confused because the values could also change from true to false even if we assign all of them to be true. So this is not the case in this case, right? So that's why I was confused in the video. I will point it out, maybe I will check it later.
So yes, I mean, see, the way the transfer functions are set up, right? We actually discussed this point even in the last interaction session, which was that you know, we basically have the equality between the in and out of a statement. I mean, when you have that, then you basically say, okay, you know, if, for example, something is getting killed, then it's definitely not lying. Even though we had started with true, we are getting to false. And now this looks like, you know, this kind of violates our principle that it only goes down. Sometimes, you know, in the beginning, it can go up as well, right? So that's what you're worried about, isn't it? Yeah, sure. I mean, you know, actually, I tried to answer this question last time as well. That, you know, first, the two answers to this question. First answer is, we can set up the data flow equations as in equations, which say that, okay, in x is less than equal to f of out x or something like that, right? I mean, so that way, you know, we won't change anything. And then the final answer will always be everything is bottom. Okay, and that would, you know, that would be also a valid way of representing the DFA. Everything else would remain the same. We would still have the same guarantees on correctness, precision, termination. Everything would remain the same. But even if we use equalities instead of inequalities, it's okay, because what will happen is, in, you know, it's basically saying that you started with true. In the first time you visit a statement, it can jump up, but then after that, it will only come down.
And sir, I had a second question. So it is about, so you told that we can start with any point. Let's say there are multiple possibilities to pick a point to resolve our, rules that are not obeyed. So in that case, I was thinking in the direction. So if we pick one point over another, it might be that according to the, based on the direction of the DFA, whether it is forward or backward, so it might be efficient to do one over another, right? Because
absolutely. So efficiency wise, picking one over the other is going to make a difference, and I discussed this later on as well. But from a final solution point of view, like what is the final solution? I'm claiming that you will get the same solution irrespective of what order you take. Okay, let's have Arpit's question.
Yeah, so I was wondering that, like we were saying that if after a statement where some expression E is assigned to X, that X is dead, we can remove that statement. So I was wondering that, like that expression could also be a function call that could cause side effects. So we should also be taking that into account, right?
Okay, that's a very valid point. And actually, you know, yeah. So one of the things about, you're absolutely right, right? If it's a function call, that could have side effects. And what are side effects? Side effects are just changes to some regions of memory, right? Which are not captured by changes to the return value. Right. We may capture that, and definitely we want to capture that. This analysis was actually dealing with statements, not function calls. So function calls that could have potential side effects would need to be modeled separately. Or maybe you would want to say that, you know, you're dead. I mean, so for one way to kind of deal with it is, if it's a function call, then you're not going to remove it. You want to assume that it's it can have side effects. The other way to model this is that, you know, you just take, you know, you just consider memory as another variable, like the rest of the memory as another variable in your system, in your analysis. And you say whether, you know, memory has been modified or not and things like that. And you basically assume, and now the boundary. So if you wanted to model side effects precisely, well, first of all, one simple solution is never eliminate function calls. It will work. If you want more precision, here is one more solution. You can have memory as another kind of quote-unquote variable in your system. You can assume that at the exit of the program, memory is, depending on whether it's a function call, if it's the main function, for example, if it's a top-level function, then at the end of the function, you can assume that memory is dead, because the program is just going to exit. You may say, oh, what about the disk? And so maybe you want to say that, okay, you may want to say distinguish between you may want to have two variables, memory and disk. You say, okay, disk is live, memory is dead at the end of the main function. Okay. If it's some internal function, then you can say both are live. Okay. And then you just basically have the same kind of transfer function, right? So basically, you know, basically say whether memory is live or not after this function call or not. So once again, let's say there was, you know, let's say basically I'm in the main function and I call foo. Somehow I know that foo is not changing the disk content. Maybe I've done some analysis of foo and I make sure that it doesn't have any system calls in it. And so and I assume that the only way to change disk content is through system calls in my program, let's say. And I know that after foo, main is just going to exit. And foo's return value is not live. Memory is not live. Foo doesn't change dead code. And so I can now eliminate foo. The call to foo. Right? So this is a more precise analysis than my first alternative, which is never eliminate function calls. Yeah. So you know you can always make the analysis more and more precise, basically capture more and more properties of your program. But yeah, the short answer is, you know, yes, we're not talking about side effects here. When I say x plus, you know, when I use the plus operator, I'm not really considering, you know, function calls that would have side effects. It's in the discussion in the lectures.
Right. So, I had one more thing. I've sent a screenshot in the chat. So this is from module 85. And in the right basic block, so at the end, like B shouldn't be live, right? Because at its successor program point, it is dead.
Could you tell me the time instant on thirteen minutes thirty-seven seconds. 13:37. Okay, and you are asking me why is B live at the end of B colon equals F plus C?
No, at the end of E colon equals E minus one. Right.
At the end of E colon equals E minus 1, why is B live? Yes, this is an error. Yeah, in fact, after B colon equals D plus E, B should not be live. And after E colon equals E minus 1, B should not be live, right? That's what you're saying,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I'll agree with that. Can you please make a comment there? Yeah, thank you.
Sure. I'll do it.
Jay?
As we saw in these lectures, that copy propagation was very similar to common sub expression elimination, but we were just focusing on some other type of expressions, right? In copy propagation, we were focusing on y was assigned to x and other in the common sub-expression elimination. And as we have discussed before that, they actually, you know, enable each other. Copy propagation would create more opportunities for common sub-expression elimination, and it would create more opportunities for copy propagation again. So, I mean, cannot we modify the transfer function and combine them into a single DFA analysis? Because can just keep expressions of the form x comma y in a common sub expression elimination as well.
Sure, absolutely. In fact, yeah, you know, the reason I discuss copy propagations separately is just because it is a simpler thing than common sub expression elimination. In fact, you can argue that sub expression elimination subsumes copy propagation, because x equals y is a subset of x equals y plus z, right? It's just, you know, just one expression, right? That's just so, and you can do it's exactly the same thing, just that it's a simpler analysis. And so oftentimes you don't, so you know what a simpler analysis also means is that it's cheaper, it's easier to reason about and so on. It's cheaper from an execution point of view of the compiler, right? It's going to have fewer DFA iterations to converge. There's fewer data structures that you need to maintain and so on. And many places that copy propagation would have sufficed for you. And so that's why, you know, it makes sense to kind of talk about copy propagation separately from common sub-expression analysis, because it's a weaker analysis. It's more efficient, it's simpler, you know, and so on, right? So why not combine both analysis? Yes, typically you would, I mean, you know, common sub-expression. The point here is, you know, when I split common sub-expression copy propagation, I was trying to show that when you do common sub-expression elimination, you create opportunities for copy propagation. When you do copy propagation, you create opportunities for common sub-expression. And then, you know, these kind of things just feed off each other, right? Actually, you could have, I could have put it in another way. Let's say I combine both of them. Then what happens is, I could have said, one pass of common sub-expression elimination creates more opportunities for common sub-expression. So I should keep doing common sub-expression elimination until I, you know, maybe I do it like 4 or 5 times or something like that. Or maybe I keep doing it until I don't find any more improvement. Till I reach a fixed point. Both are valid options. Okay, in fact, I discussed one of these. I call this deep common sub-expression elimination. So what is deep common sub-expression elimination? You just run common sub-expression elimination a few times, and it becomes deeper common sub-expression, because one pass of CSE, common sub-expression elimination, enables more CSE optimization opportunities. Okay, and I, you know, initially I'm just talking, in the initial kind of discussion, I'm just showing this as interplay between common sub-expression elimination and copy propagation. But yes, it's actually true even for common sub-expression with itself. Great. Anirudh?
So I have a, we were discussing right now that if X is assigned a function, some sort of function or a method that might potentially modify X, I got a much more fundamental doubt. It's related to the intermediate representation in this case. Maybe I don't recall this, but if there is a statement X is assigned some function call, so what would be the intermediate representation here? Is the function call treated as a jump in the code and does warrant a separate basic block for the function call?
Okay, that's a great question, actually. So, you know, if it's a function call, then how am I modeling it in the IR? And I guess I didn't discuss this in the lecture modules, but basically a function call, the IR, for example, the tree address code IR, like the LLVM IR, also has a function call abstraction. That's what it has. So a function call in the high level language like C just translates to a function call in the IR level language as well. And so in the IR level language also, every function has an entry point which has a name. Think of it as an address of the start of the function. So that's the first part of the function call, and then a list of arguments, which are just expressions. Which are in LLVM IR or in any tree address code IR, it's going to be the register name. So that's what a function call looks like. Right? So it's not a jump, it's a function call. A jump is a branch is different from a function call. Okay? It's only later when we convert it to assembly do we convert function calls to branches. And then we deal with, and then we kind of also have to manipulate stack and stuff like that, right? And return address and things like that. But at the IR level, we don't talk about any of that. It's just a function call, just like it is in C.
So basically, the code of the function call doesn't appear in the IR. It just has a single instruction line or something.
Right. It's a single instruction line, just like it is. I mean, you would first evaluate. So let's say I say in my C program, let's say I had A equals foo of B plus C. Then in the IR, in the tree address code, I would first compute B plus C into some temporary T, and then I would say B equals foo of T. Right? So I would split the argument computation, and then I would actually do the function call. Right. Okay, great. Sonu?
I had a question about the worst case execution time of Leibniz DFA analysis that you discussed. So we know that there are two values, and the and for a particular variable, the value can change just twice. So the execution time came out to be 2 into n, which where n is a number of statements. But is it for one variable, or is it like for the entire program?
So in this discussion, I'm talking about when I'm interested in finding. Are you talking about the constant propagation formulation, or are you talking about the Leibniz formulation?
Leibniz formulation.
So yeah, when I'm talking, so here in this particular discussion, I'm talking about a single variable. So I'm interested in finding out what are all the program points at which this particular variable is live.
Right.
Now, just for this problem, the runtime is 2 into the number of statements, right?
Okay. So if you have to do it for, sorry.
Yeah, but if you wanted to do it for, you know, let's say 10 different variables, then option number one is to do the same procedure one for every variable separately. And the option number two is to actually do all the variables simultaneously. And so this is something that we've discussed previously as well, that doing things simultaneously can potentially be faster. Right. We're going to discuss how to do things simultaneously later on. But here is a very rough intuition, right? We're just going to maintain a set of everything that is live. So if you belong to the set, then you know, it's equivalent to saying that it's equivalent to the truth. If you don't belong to the set, it's equivalent to the false value.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Jay?
So last time we discussed, so we said that it's on the execution time as well. So we said that when we do the analysis for all the variables together, apart from, say, data as in time improvement due to data structures or other stuff, we had a theoretical advantage as well that if, say, x is y plus z, so if y and z are constant at that point, then we can also conclude that x was constant at that point. So can we have some similar advantage in case of Leibniz analysis, say if y or z were dead or something, or live?
Okay, great. So let's revisit that constant propagation just, you know, so that we remind ourselves. Basically, the question that Jay is asking is, I could have had two different types of transfer functions for constant propagation. If I'm doing constant propagation for multiple variables simultaneously. One idea is that if you see x equals y plus z, you just raise your hand and say not a constant. That's option number one. Option number two, no, you don't raise your hand. You just say, you ask whether y is a constant. Say yes, if the answer is yes. You check whether z is a constant, if the answer is yes. Then you say, both y and z are constants. I know what their values are through my constant propagation analysis so far. I just use that and sum that and just basically add whatever is the answer, I add that to either mapping from x to that value. That's option number two. And I said that the second option is more precise than the first option, but it's also more complex in the sense, most of the kind of the properties of DFA still remain. Okay, and we want to discuss what the properties are and why they remain and so on. You know, I haven't really discussed it so far. We could in the future lecture modules, and we discuss this point in detail. It becomes more precise. Right. So it becomes more precise, everything else, you know, correctness and everything is okay. Now, also termination guarantees remain, okay, so that's great. Also worst case execution time guarantees remain, so all that's also great. Now, question is that in Leibniz, do we have a similar pattern, right, that you could have had a more precise transfer function? Yes, I mean, so, you know, right now, for example, our transfer function is that if it's getting used, then it's live, right? So that's a syntactic transfer function. So if I say, if I have x equals y plus z, then I just assume that y is going to be live at the beginning of the statement. So that's option number one. Option number two is x equals y plus z. So y is going to be live at the beginning of the statement if x is live at the end of the statement. If x is dead at the end of the statement, then why do I care about x equals y plus z? And so y is also dead. Right? So in this transfer function, if at the end of x equals y plus z, both x and y are dead, then in the beginning of this statement, x and y would be still dead. That's option number two. Option number one was, oh, syntactic. X equals y plus z, y is getting used on the RHS of the 3-letter code, y is live at the beginning of the statement. That's option number one, easy option. More complex, more involved option, x equals y plus z, check whether x is also live at the end of the statement or not. Right? And if it is not live, and if y is also not live at the end of the statement, then y is dead at the beginning of the statement. Because, you know, this computation is not meaningful. Right? So that will be the more complex version. Now, it can be argued that we don't really need this complexity. And typically this complexity is not implemented, especially for liveness kind of things, because this same effect can be achieved by just implementing or executing getcode elimination multiple times. Right? So first I say, x is dead. So then getcode elimination is just going to get rid of x equals y plus z. And then when I run liveness again after that, then y will automatically turn out to be dead. Okay. So, you know, there are multiple ways of doing the same thing, but yes, if you make the analysis more precise by changing the transfer function so that it becomes more discerning, then you get more precise results, even for life. Okay, Arpit.
Yeah, so I had sort of a general question that, like, I've read that compilers and even CPUs can reorder instructions so that they are more efficient in some way. So, first question would be, like, do compilers do that, or is that, like, left to the CPUs? And if they do that, then how, like, if you can give a basic high level idea.
Okay, so can compilers reorder instructions? Can CPUs reorder instructions? The answer to both these questions is yes. And they typically do. Okay, in fact, maybe so far we haven't looked at examples where instructions are getting reordered. But we're going to very soon see examples of instruction programs or transformations where we're going to reorder instructions. The question is, when you reorder instructions, first of all, when you reorder instructions, you basically do that only when you preserve the meaning of the program. Okay. So, firstly, why do we reorder instructions? Oftentimes, reordering improves runtime, right? For example, better scheduling, right? So if there was, maybe you want to increase the length of the, so let's say you generate a value, you say x equals y plus z. It's a five-stage pipeline. If you recall your computer architecture course, it's a five-stage pipeline. Then if you do x equals y plus z, and then you do a equals x plus b, then there is a dependency, there's a read after write dependency between these two statements. So second statement has a read on a variable x that was written by the first statement. Now, if it was a five-stage pipeline, then there could be a pipeline stall because of this read after write dependency. So that would make the program slower. So one way to improve this is to, take some unrelated computation that's happening after these two statements and put it in the middle of these two statements. Right, so that particular cycle can be used in executing something else before you plan. So you kind of avoid that stall. And this is being done both by compilers and by CPU, right? And it's a very, very common thing to do. It happens all the time. All right, so the question is, so can you repeat the question? I forgot what the question related to this.
I just wanted to ask about how it could be done. So like it could be modeled as a DSA or something, or like
how will we reorder? You know, we're going to look at some examples of transformation. Of course, you know, it doesn't make sense to just reorder for the sake of reordering, right? I mean, of course, there needs to be a reason. And I just gave you an example of a reason, right? There are more reasons. So here is one more reason, right? That let's say in a loop, I'm computing a value. Let's say I'm computing x equals y plus z inside a loop. But in that loop, y plus z is just loop invariant, which means across different iterations of the loop, y doesn't change, z doesn't change. Then it doesn't make sense to keep recomputing y plus z for every iteration of the loop. Why don't I just compute y plus z once in the beginning and then kind of just reuse that result over and over again, right? I mean, that way I will save thousands of operations, right? Because for every one operation for every loop iteration. So we're going to discuss this. This is called loop invariant code motion. We're going to discuss this later in the course. We're going to also discuss an algorithm, how we are going to do this. It's going to involve DSA. All right. We haven't yet discussed such of transformations, but you know, definitely on the roadmap. And there are actually many, many different ways of doing this. This is going to be a very common transformation. And we're going to learn more about it later in the course.
So this is based on the discussion we had a few minutes back regarding how do we put functions in a data flow analysis. So you gave that example, let's say if A is equal to foo of B plus C, then using three address code will make B plus C equal to T, and then foo of D will be A. So this is so what happens if an argument is passed by reference? So will that be handled in a different way? Let's say B is getting changed within the function.
Okay. That's an excellent question. Does anybody want to answer, or kind of, you know, maybe somebody already has some experience with this? How do you, so all these things have been passed, everything is kind of value-based, right? All our discussion so far has been value-based. We're only talking about values. Even for function calls, when you are passing, so in, for example, a three-address code, when I pass an argument to a function, it's a pass by value. It doesn't support like three other things like LLVM don't support pass by reference at all. Okay, they only support pass by value. So if the high level language was a language like, let's say, C++, which supports pass by reference, then what does that code look like at LLVM IR level, right? Anybody wants to take a stab at it?
The references would just get translated to a pointer, and IR can support pointers. That's support.
Sorry, pointers. They will get translated to what? Sorry.
To pointers.
To pointers, yeah. That's the answer. Absolutely. So references are a higher level abstraction for pointers. No, just give you better type system, and they could give you better. You know, you don't have to kind of deal with them manually. You cannot, you know, things like that. But basically, when you translate them to IR level, at the IR level, we don't want to reason about them values separately, because at the IR level, we are really interested in optimization. And so this will just add more complexity. It's actually, fortunately, not required, that complexity. And so if we just convert it to pointers and then just pass around pointers and then kind of, I mean, so that's how references get translated. So pass by reference is nothing but pass by value of the corresponding address or the point. All right, I think we are, looks like we are done with the questions. Thanks for all the nice questions. And we are also almost at the end of our time slot. So great. Who is doing the notes for this week, this interaction session?
I'm doing it.
Okay, so great. So thanks, Jay. So yeah, look forward to reading the notes. And we're going to look, we're going to study the next set of lectures, which are going to start from 86 to, let's say, 90. I'm going to post that on the group as well, on the channel as well. But yeah, just, I mean, of course, it's good. It's going to be just a continuation of what we've been looking at. Okay, thank you.
So I had something to ask about the assignment. So basically, benchmark on the some Intel compilers and some on OZO optimization level is taking a lot of time. It's been more than 2 days for me. So can something be done about it?
I see. Is anybody else facing the same problem?
Yeah, actually, the ICX benchmarking is taking a lot of time. Even though the first O0 run has been running for about a day for me.
Okay, then I would say just put a timeout of, let's say, 24 hours. If something doesn't finish in 24 hours, just report that, and that's good enough. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Bye.